Hey, Living Rock family, whether this is your first time watching one of our sermons or you've been a part of Living Rock for many, many years, we are so glad that you clicked on our video today. We would love to hear from you after the sermon is over. If God spoke to you through the message, just laid something on your heart, share it with us. Send us an email or call us on the phone. We would love to know what God is doing through Living Rock Church for you. We'd also love the chance to connect with you. So like us on Facebook, follow us on Instagram, and check out our website for all of the events and things that we have going on in the church. You can also get connected with all of our ministries or with Pastor Ryan. There's so much we have to offer, and we can't wait to share it with you.
Reading from the New American Standard Version. We can read it out loud. I think they put it on the screen for you. At least it's on the screen I'm looking at. Let's read it together. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show this all surpassing power is of God and not from us. Some translations say we have this treasure in earthen vessels, earthen containers, so that the extraordinary greatness of the power will be of God and not from ourselves. How many saw the recent, I'm a weather guy, so I love the Weather Channel, and I had the weather app on my phone, and I saw the recent post of a woman on a California beach was walking along, and she saw this strange object in the sand. Did anybody read about that? And she just stepped over it, but she took a picture of it. She posted it online. Someone else obviously picked it up, but a paleontologist saw what she took a picture of online and determined that it was from a prehistoric mastodon. And she just walked right by it and took a picture. Sure, she wished she picked it up. Someone else picked it up and did turn it in. But it reminded me for just a moment of how many things that we might have in our possession or have within reach of us that we truly don't know the value of. A man found a Nintendo game in the attic of his childhood home. When he took it to auction, it brought in $9,000. A Nintendo game. How many remember Nintendo? Yeah. An old pair of Air Jordan sneakers that a man was about ready to throw away turned out they had been signed by the man himself, and he had worn them. They too were taken to auction. It's funny how once we know the value of something, our attitude towards it changes. A woman in Copang, France, was getting ready to sell her house, so she brought an auctioneer in to kind of determine the value of her belongings. And the auctioneer quickly noticed that over her stove was a painting. It was from the 13th century. It was a long-lost work of art from the Florentine artist Cimabue. The masterpiece was known as Christ Mocked, part of a series of paintings that depict Jesus' crucifixion. The painting went up to auction and sold for $26.8 million. Think about it. The chief curator, Xavier Solomon, said to the Washington Post, just think of what that painting has been through. He wasn't talking about her kitchen. But the wars, the French Revolution, and the number of other wars. And there it was all the time over her stove. Needless to say, the painting's no longer over her stove. It reminds me of another story. A few years ago, a man bought a home in Michigan and was entertaining some dinner guests. And one of the women who was at his dinner table was a geologist from the Central Michigan State University. And when they went out to the barn, she noticed a rock that he'd been using as a doorstop. Well, it turned out that when she asked if she could take the rock and have it examined, that it was a meteorite worth over $100,000 that he was using as a doorstop for his barn. A college professor said when she got some help with the Smithsonian, imagine I'm holding a piece of the solar system in my hands. I've been playing tennis with a guy for several years in Madison. And recently I just found out, I just happened to ask him in between sets, so what did you do? I never really like to ask that question because then people ask me, well, what do you do? And that can lead to some awkward moments, as you might say, might imagine. But what he did, he said he was the founder, one of the founding partners for WebMD, and worked with Obama on Obamacare and with other presidents, Bill Clinton and with George W. Bush. And I've been playing tennis with him all this time. I still didn't give him a break on the tennis court, just in case you wanted to know. Jessica Crandall, member of this body here, just finished a 112-mile race yesterday afternoon from the Massachusetts border all the way down to the Guilford Sound. Did you know she could do that? Just stand up. I just want people to see who you are. This little woman here, 112 miles. She ran the course in 29 hours and 46 minutes, beating the former record of 31 hours and 26 minutes. Let's give her another hand. Listen, I want to talk to you about the Holy Spirit, and I'm telling you all those stories because we have no idea of the value of the Holy Spirit that's been given to us. Amen. And of the Holy Spirit that is within this body, this local church. Because the Holy Spirit is not just something to believe. The Holy Spirit is not just a third person of the Godhead, of the Trinity, part of our church doctrine, a part of Reformation tradition, something we're to know about. The Holy Spirit is to be experienced. The Holy Spirit is to be communed with. The Holy Spirit is to be dependent upon. And if we're to have a proper appreciation of the gift of the Holy Spirit, we need to take time. Take a few minutes. Because do we just keep the Holy Spirit around? Do we just keep him over there? Do we just keep going about our lives and walking past without ever noticing? Like the guy opened the barn door for several years, not realizing he's holding it open with a $100,000 meteorite. The Holy Spirit alone has the power to transform us. The Holy Spirit alone has the power to sanctify us. The Holy Spirit alone has the power to welcome us into the community of God and the community of faith. I don't know where I'd be today without the Holy Spirit. I know I would not be in New England. I just know that because it was the Holy Spirit that brought me here. It was His voice that I first heard. Where would you be if you hadn't depended on the Holy Spirit? And when you last moved, did you move because the Holy Spirit was directing you to move? Or did you just move on your own and then hope that He would follow? It takes more than just a building. It takes more than just some lights. It takes more than just some chairs and a few people to make the church. We are formed as a community by the Holy Spirit. We didn't just slap a building together and put a sign out and throw some chairs in and, you know, just come up with some catchy thing and see who will come. We're a work of the Holy Spirit. We are a work of the Holy Spirit. Paul felt so strongly about the church as the temple of the Holy Spirit. He said this: if any man destroys the temple of God, God will destroy him. For the temple of God is holy. And that's what you are. Holy. In other words, we never want to do anything to defile the temple of God. He's talking about the collective, the church, the body. We don't want to profane the temple of God or mock it. Or polluted. So how is it that we are to live in all that is possible since we've received the gift of the Holy Spirit? In the Gospel of John, this is on the evening of the first day of the week, the disciples are all together, John chapter 20, they're all together, the doors are locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, all of a sudden Jesus stands among them. And as Jesus comes into the room, The first words out of his mouth are, "Peace be with you." After he said that, the Bible tells us he showed them his hands and his side. And the disciples were overjoyed when they saw it was the Lord. And then again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you." And then he said, he breathed upon them. This was intentional to blow upon them. And he said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit." Then he said, "If you forgive any men their sins, they'll be forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they will not be forgiven." So what is the significance of Jesus breathing on these disciples? I first want you to know that these disciples of Jesus did not have our contemporary understanding of the Holy Spirit at that time. They had a Jewish understanding of the Holy Spirit. And the Jewish understanding of the Holy Spirit is that the Spirit of God is simply an extension of God. And it's like he fills the temple with his presence. It's God over there. And in order to participate and be in God's presence, you had to be a part of the Levitical priesthood. You had to go through several rites and washings and special clothing. And this is how you came into the presence of God. That's what the Jews knew of the Holy Spirit. There was no concept of a permanent presence, indwelling of God's Spirit. In fact, for Jews, the concept of Messiah meant simply this, that God would work through a human who was the Messiah. But Jesus told us what? That God is also Messiah. That Jesus Christ is God. Jews didn't understand that. They believed that God would put his Spirit on a human and they would be Messiah. And there have been many persons before Jesus who came who reflected that kind of an idea, but they were not the true Messiah. How many are still with me this morning? So with the resurrection of Jesus, there's a whole new concept, a whole new understanding of the Holy Spirit. The disciples on the road to Emmaus, you remember when on the first day of the week and they've left Jerusalem and Jesus comes walking among them, and the scripture says that Jesus, he didn't reveal himself at that time to them, but he walked with them. Their eyes were withheld from knowing him, and he began at Moses and all the prophets and began to expound things concerning somebody else, himself. I am the Messiah. You know, their eyes began to gradually be opened, and it wasn't until Jesus took the bread and he broke it that then their eyes were open and they recognized this is Jesus. He's the Messiah. And this is what caused their hearts to burn in them. They got it. Jesus is the Messiah. He wasn't just a man who came and died. He is the one. "Peace be unto you. As the Father sends me, so I am sending you." After saying that, he breathes on them in John 20. "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive any man their sins, they'll be forgiven. If you retain their sins of any, they're retained." Breath is something that's not outside of us. It's in us. It's within us. This is the idea, Jesus. The breath, the Spirit is going to dwell within you like breath. You've got wind within you. Breathing on them was not just to give them a spiritual experience. Breathing on them was not to give them some kind of moral authority in the world. Breathing on them was so that now they could act on the rest of the world the way Jesus had acted onto the world and bring the kingdom of God wherever they went. It was a Pentecostal preview, is what's happening in the upper room. Because they will later be then asked to remain in Jerusalem until they be filled with power, power for the mission. A greater empowerment was indeed coming. So in ministry, we all need to remember that the Holy Spirit is not just for a select few. The Holy Spirit has been given for everyone. He breathes on every one of us. So here's what's important. The Holy Spirit is not over there, but right here. Jewish understanding, Holy Spirit's over there. Holy Spirit's in the temple. Spirit's coming upon a man, like the Spirit came upon Samson, or the Spirit came upon Gideon. But now the Spirit is within, like breath. Like breath. Now, this is so important, but it seems that there's a delayed response. Because the very next chapter, this happens on the first day of the week, Resurrection Day, Jesus with his disciples. But the very next chapter, which happens sometime the day after the first day, after this experience, John 21:2, Simon Peter, also known as Didymus, and Thomas, known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, two of the disciples were together. And here's what Peter says. I'm going fishing. I'm going to fish, Simon Peter told them, and they said, we're going with you. So they went out, got in the boat, but they caught nothing. Now this is what caused me to kind of wonder. You just had Jesus breathe on you. Receive the Holy Spirit. You've just been ordained. Forgive sins or retain sins. And you're going fishing. Clearly, somebody is missing the point. This to me is the proverbial walking by the meteorite, thinking it's just a doorstop. This is the walking by the mastodon 1-foot-long jawbone on the beach, not knowing what it is. Peter clearly does not know what has just happened. And neither do the other guys, for that matter. And neither do us sometimes know how to receive the Holy Spirit. I think we have a reception problem. Instead of receiving the Holy Spirit, Peter goes back to the boat. Have you ever met somebody like this? I mean, they were visibly touched by God in a service. You prayed with them and you knew God, you sensed God. There was a moment. So what are you going to do? Well, I guess I'm going to go to work. I guess I'm going to mow the grass. So I'm going to go pull some weeds. You know, kind of like, really? You don't want to just take a moment and just kind of think about what just happened? Kind of reflect on it a little bit? We don't know what it means. Do we really have a just appreciation for the fact that God has put his breath in our soul? And maybe this is why when Peter went fishing, he caught nothing. Because again, I think God chases us into obedience. I think he chases us into obedience. We're kind of slow. So, of course, he goes after those disciples on the road to Emmaus. Where's Emmaus? Well, it's not Jerusalem. And Jerusalem's not home. And yet for Jews, Jerusalem was to be home. It's where everything happened that made you Jewish. Was in Jerusalem. Have we taken the time, all of us in this room, to really understand just who it is who's breathing in our soul right now? Amen. Who's this person who's breathing in me? Who's put his breath in me? Just maybe. I'm going to give Peter this. I think maybe he feels unworthy. You know, maybe he feels he denied the Lord. And maybe some of us, we don't know how to process this gift of the Holy Spirit's been given to us because we struggle with unworthiness. We feel that we can't be forgiven. We feel unclean. We feel dirty. We feel we made the mistakes. And so we're unworthy. Maybe this gift is for somebody else. We think, well, you know, pastors, they need to be ordained and they need to have the Holy Spirit, and certainly prophets and people who function in these other gift ministries, they need the Holy Spirit. But, you know, I don't know that I really need the Holy Spirit. Well, apparently God thinks we do. We can't live like the Holy Spirit has no application for us in every facet of our lives. And maybe is that what drove Peter back to the boat? Because it's just what he knew. It's just what I know. It's been pretty exciting around here in the last couple days, you know, getting arrested, running in the garden, denying the Lord, and the crucifixion, and now the resurrection. I don't know. I just got to go do something normal. And fishing's what I know. Is that what he's thinking? And yet Jesus pursues Peter. Next thing you know, Jesus is walking on the beach. They've caught nothing. And Jesus says, "Have you caught anything?" And they say, "No, nothing." John hears the voice of Jesus and says, "It's the Lord." It's interesting that John recognized the voice of the shepherd and Peter didn't. But when John said it was the Lord, Peter goes into action. And he jumps into the water about 100 yards offshore, and he makes it to the beach. And Jesus has got a fire going, and he's made these guys breakfast. After breakfast, Jesus takes a walk with Peter and says, "Peter, do you love me?" And he says, "Feed my lambs." "Peter, do you love me? Feed my lambs." "Peter, do you love me?" And this time, Peter, just a little bit concerned about the repetition of this, says, "Lord, you know that I love you." And Jesus says, "Then feed my sheep." And Peter is commissioned into a new ministry. No longer fishing, but fishing for men. A teacher, a preacher, a leader, a disciple maker himself, an elder, he will call himself in his epistle in 1 Peter. And he will exhort other elders. His identity has been transformed all because of the Lord breathing upon him. This happens before Acts 2 Pentecost. All this that I've been speaking of happens before Acts 2 Pentecost. Peter experiences this commissioning in ministry. Will we allow the Holy Spirit to transform our lives in a similar way, to reposition us, to talk to us about what we find is so important about our identity and change that identity? Is it that important, what you've identified yourself as? How important is it? Can the Holy Spirit reassign you an identity? He can and does. Can he take our ordinary vocations and transform them as well? Because we think, well, God can't use a landscaper like me, or a welder, or an architect, or a draftsman. Sure, he can. He wants to use whatever your vocation is and bring it up to a whole other level than what you've been seeing it as. It's not just a job. It's an assignment. An assignment where the Holy Spirit can then use you in your assignment and speak to you and transform it into something that other than just making a living. Second Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7. We have this treasure in jars of clay, so that the extraordinary greatness of the power will be of God and not from ourselves. Notice, but and we. At the beginning of the verse, but and we. Who is the we? The we is us. It's those of us who believe, those of us who have seen his light Those of us who have received His truth, have received the Holy Spirit, who have His Spirit within us. We believers, we are the jars of clay that have this treasure. And that treasure is power like the wind. We have power. But we are nothing. I was just helping my wife move some clay pots from our garden, get them up closer to the house where they could be watered. And one was cracked. How many know we are all a little fractured? And we don't take moves too easily. But listen to what Paul says about these jars of clay. In the very next verses, verse 8 and 9, we're hard pressed on every side, but we're not crushed. We're perplexed, but we're not in despair. We're persecuted, but we're not abandoned. We're struck down, but we're not destroyed. Why is that? Why is it that these jars of clay of ours can be so mistreated? These jars can be so abused. These jars can be so impacted by the world around us. And yet Paul says, but we're not crushed by this. We're persecuted, but we're not abandoned. We're struck down, but we're not destroyed. Why is that? Because there is a power. Because the power of the Holy Spirit is within us, keeping us intact. Despite all the outside pressure, despite whatever's going on around you, the Holy Spirit. And we see this evidence throughout the book of Acts as these very men are sent into the world with not just the word, but with power. That's what we said last week. Paul says, our gospel didn't come to you and just, this is not just words. We're not just carrying around words. The gospel is not just words. The gospel is power. And thankfully for these this morning whom we laid hands on and confirmed, they had words, yes, but with those words came some power. With those words came not just understanding, with those words came some breath, came a wind that strengthens them, encourages them, gives them staying power, convicting power, pursuing power to hang in there. When it gets tough, when it gets raw, when it gets uncomfortable. How many times, I wonder, have I not leaned on the Holy Spirit when I could have and suffered needlessly? How many times was the Holy Spirit leading me? And I just wouldn't take the hint. I wouldn't take the leading because I already had made up my mind as what I wanted to do. You know. As Paul warns us not to grieve the Holy Spirit. You see, the Holy Spirit is not a power, just a power. He's a person. He's referred to in the scripture as a he. Jesus said, I will send the Comforter. He's a person. Not just a power, not just a wind, but a person who is like the wind that you don't see, but you can feel. You don't see, but you can look at the impact. You don't see, but you can hear. You can detect it with the organ of your ear, not with your eyes, but hearing. I identify with Peter, who's just been through a lot. All these disciples have been through a lot. You've been through a lot. We've all been through a lot. If we were to take a microphone and go around, tell us your story. You've been through a lot. Except for some of these teenagers here. I don't know how much you've been through just yet, but you'll go through a lot. You've been through enough already. Some of you have been through a lot. You're wondering, how am I standing right now? How did I get through that? Maybe it was the power that was within you. Maybe it was the Holy Spirit. And I think it's time that we gave pause and paid notice that we don't treat the Holy Spirit in our lives with the proper value. Amen. We value his presence. That we wait. You see, I found this about the Holy Spirit. He's a gentleman. He never does this. Get out of the way, Ryan. I'm in charge. He didn't do that. Step aside. He's not an exhibitionist either. He'd say, go ahead. You want to do it? Go ahead. I'm right over here when you need me. He's a gentleman. But we need the Holy Spirit, church. The power of the Holy Spirit. And I wonder, I pray that churches all around this country, all around this globe will just not devalue the Holy Spirit. He's been given. God, Christ has breathed on us, and he's breathing on us now. He's breathing on his church now. Who's going to receive him? And sadly, many just have the attitude, well, I'm going fishing. I'm going to just do what I've been doing. Don't understand the impact. Don't understand the value. Don't understand what they have been given. Just like we don't understand. We've got a Jess here who's running. We've got this person here who's done this and accomplished that. We've got people in our body here that we don't even know. We need to get to know how God has worked in their lives. Because I don't understand what causes some people to do what they do. Maybe it's the Holy Spirit.